Welcome to Firing Line. I'm Michael Kinsley of the New Republic magazine. From the Bolshevik uprising of October 1917 to the collapse of the Berlin Wall in November 1989 is a span of 72 years. That was the reign of Soviet communism as a power in world affairs. For more than half of that time, four decades, Richard Pipes has been researching and writing his study of the Russian Revolution, published at last in 1990 by Knopf. It is the first comprehensive history of that cataclysmic event in any language, including Russian, a language the Soviets are now translating it into. I'm sure no one is more delighted than Professor Pipes that the long-awaited publication of his book, The Russian Revolution, coincides with the success of the counter-revolution. And I'm reasonably sure that this fact doesn't mitigate his judgment expressed in the second line of that book, that the Russian Revolution is, quote, arguably the most important event of the century. Although his book concentrates on the years 1905 to 1918, Professor Pipes maintains that the revolution itself, with its goal of total economic, social, and cultural transformation, was not consummated until the height of the Stalinist terror in the 1930s. Bolshevism's three great political innovations, he says, were the one-party state, the omnipotent political police, and the concentration camp. The police state created in 1917 and after by the Bolsheviks, he says, became the model for all 20th century dictatorships, including Nazism. Richard Pipes is Baird Professor of History at Harvard. In the first 2 years of the Reagan administration, he served as the National Security Council as an advisor on the NSC on Soviet and Eastern European affairs. Mr. Buckley, as Professor Pipes points out, the Bolsheviks didn't just want to transform society, they wanted to transform human beings to create the new Soviet man. What strikes me as most surprising about the developments of the past couple of years is how completely they failed at that. As soon as people had freedom, they seemed to know exactly what to do with it. The democratic instinct was still there, and they were picked up these arguments about things like nationalism where they had dropped them 70 years before. Am I naive to be surprised?
Well, let me address that question to you, because had a lot of experience in the last 15 years with the Mao man. And one American sinologist said the difference between Soviet totalitarianism and Chinese totalitarianism is as follows. They give you an infinitely long list of things that you can't do under Bolshevism, but anything that they don't list, you can do. Whereas under Maoism, you can't do anything. Yeah. You have to ask permission to do anything whatsoever. Your book is interesting and fascinating for a number of reasons. Among them that the intellectuals, although anti the existing order, were not pro-Bolshevik.
Yes, the intelligentsia in Russia was on the whole left of center, mm-hmm. As intelligentsias are almost everywhere. But they naively believed that a change of the economic system will produce a change of culture and a change in human type. They very quickly realized that it's not possible, and they're appalled by the fact that the Bolshevik government applied force to transform society and transform men.
Now, that intelligentsia, is it in your judgment, did they in your judgment have a critical hand in the events of the 1980s that led to the collapse of the Bolshevik order?
Yes, they certainly did, because from the moment Stalin died, when it was possible in some limited way to start protesting the status quo, in the forefront were not the workers, nor the peasants, nor the bureaucrats, but the intellectuals. Unfortunately, intellectuals are far better at criticizing than at managing. And we see today a rather helpless position in the Soviet Union. The same thing happened in 1917. They were, you know, the main enemies of the Tsarist regime. They were the main group that brought the Tsarist regime down. And yet, when the Tsarist regime collapsed, they couldn't manage things. And things fell right away into the hands of extreme left-wingers headed by Lenin.
Well, the myth is very widely propounded that the intelligentsia in 1917 were active, so to speak, coadjutors of Lenin. Your history makes it very plain this was not the case, that they resisted the November revolution. At that point, they became very submissive, did they not?
Well, yes and no. Intellectuals there, as in many other parts of the world, had a very ambivalent attitude towards the Bolshevik experiment. They didn't approve of it. And yet, they felt that the cause which Bolshevism represented was in some way progressive, whereas the cause of capitalism was regressive. So they would criticize Lenin in his face and resist him very often. Well, later on they became submissive because he said submitted to terror. Mm-hmm. But yet if anyone else criticized or attacked Lenin, they lined up with him. So for example, during the critical civil war, the socialist intelligentsia sided with the Bolsheviks and not with the whites. And they were against the Allied intervention very vociferously. So there was always this curious ambivalence of left-wingers in general, that is to criticize Lenin and the Bolsheviks face to face because they're part of the same family, but if anybody from the outside came and criticized, they rallied behind Lenin and the Bolsheviks.
Well, that leads me to a point in your book, which I'd like to hear you out on. The first time I went to the Soviet Union was under the auspices of the USIA, I was briefed. And two or three of the briefing officers said, now look, there's one thing you must take very seriously, and that's Lenin. Mm-hmm. You can make your bathroom jokes about Stalin and so on and so forth, and you're all right, but don't touch Lenin. And when I marched through and saw him embalmed in his tomb, I felt the irradiation of his historical memory. Now, here they're going to publish this book in the Soviet Union, and the devastating analysis of Lenin, both historically, ideologically, and as a human being, is the supreme act of iconoclasm that I can think of. What kind of response do you anticipate to this regicide?
Well, it is a very touchy point, because Lenin is the party, Lenin is the October Revolution. If you knock Lenin off the pedestal, there's really nothing left. Mm-hmm. But I think that the anti-communist force in the Soviet Union has progressed sufficiently now for them to find it acceptable. I had a review in Izvestia 2 weeks ago where the reviewer said that this book argues that there is a direct connection between Lenin and Stalin. And the picture he paints of Lenin is going to strike, surprise many Russian readers. But he stated it, and then went ahead to provide some of the evidence which is in the book. So they must be getting ready for this.
Well, would you go so far as to say that his tomb is the last remaining emblem mm-hmm. of the legitimacy of the revolution, and that only when it goes away will we be able to say that the counter-revolution has finally been realized?
Symbolically, yes. You know why they built this tomb? Because Russian masses, Russian peasants in particular, believed that if you are a saint, if there is a saint, his body does not decompose after death. So all the monasteries had relics, bodies of saints, which were venerated. The Bolsheviks in 1919 exposed them, a sham. They showed that they really are dolls or rags or what have you, or nothing but skeletons. And yet in 1924, when Lenin died, they had recourse to the same method because they knew the superstitious people coming from the countryside would look at this and said, yes, he's intact, he's dead, and yet he is intact, he's not corrupted, he's not decomposed, Lenin lives. So yes, symbolically, Lenin's body is removed from the mausoleum. That will be the end of the cult.
Do you predict it?
Well, yes and no. I think if things progress the way they have, yes. But there are signs that the right groups are becoming very impatient with all of this. And it's entirely possible that they will in the next few months strike and by means of a putsch impose a right-wing dictatorship, with or without Gorbachev. If that happens, then we're going to see a cult of Lenin being revived and copies of my Russian translation being impounded.
you recently wrote an op-ed page piece in which you evaluated the whole problem of the generals, and you described a discontented class a class that is a genuine threat to whatever evolutionary progress we see going on now. Could you elaborate on this a little bit? Is this Putsch conceivable?
Yes, it is conceivable. In fact, it's threatened all the time. Middle of September, many Moscovites believed that the Putsch was ready in the making, because and several
Gorbachev
divisions
ordered that investigation.
Several divisions of troops were surrounded Moscow. I think it's not just the army. It's the upper echelons of the army, the upper echelons of the KGB, and the upper echelons of the party that find the process of disintegration of the Union impossible to accept, because if the Republic succeed in taking power away from Moscow, including the Russian Republic, then they're left holding an empty bag. They have no authority. They are national organizations. They want to stay as national organizations. They cannot allow a separate Russian army, a separate Russian KGB, or a Georgian army, or a Georgian KGB. And I think that if Gorbachev does not succeed in arriving at some kind of modus vivendi with the Republican presidents and legislatures, they may very well move in.
Mm-hmm. you mentioned that just as in the general class, they about 3-1 opposed these reforms, in the junior officer class, it's 3-1 on the other
right,
side.
Right, it's correct.
They want democratization.
Yeah.
But is it your assumption that the generals command de facto as well as de jure the movements of the subordinates?
That's hard to say. That is, there are many Russians who believe the Putsch would not succeed because the troops would not obey, particularly the non-Russian troops. And there's a large number of non-Russians, particularly Muslims and Ukrainians. So many people question the possibility of success. But I remember in 81 when I dealt with Solidarity people, I discussed with them the possibility of a crackdown, internal crackdown. They were very optimistic. It could not happen.
Mm-hmm.
They said the Polish army will not move against the Polish people. And that is why they were caught, all of them in a net, exactly a year ago.
Yeah, right.
When the crackdown occurred, because they were so overconfident. And I have that feeling with many Russian intellectuals that they too are overconfident. It can be done.
Well, on the basis of what you reveal about the revolution and its history, what are the primary lessons that should be drawn from a knowledge of your book by the Bush administration?
Well, by the Bush administration, if you're speaking, I mean, I would like to discuss on two levels, on the practical level and the philosophical level.
Sure.
On the practical level, you have to be very careful in trying to interpret affairs inside Russia, and particularly trying to interfere in internal Russian affairs. I think it's very risky what the president is doing right now in trying to bolster Gorbachev and ignoring, as it were, the pressures for independence on the part of the Baltic states and the other republics. Washington is not amenable to any contacts with these groups. We have received in Washington the foreign minister of Russia and the leader of the Latvians, but on the whole, we are hostile to it. I think this is a mistake. You have to study the situation very closely as it develops and not come with any preconceptions. On the philosophical level, which is really what my book is about, and I will deal with that in the sequel called Russian as a New Regime, what I've learned from all of this is that you cannot impose any patterns on human life to tell people how to live, how to organize society. You just can't do it.
Well, you can over the short term, can't you? They did.
Well, by terror you can, but I mean, they were not operating short term. They, for example, they resorted to terror in the belief that this is just short term, but it turned out to be long term.
Yeah.
And
consumed a lifetime.
Well, just two generations.
72 years.
Yeah, two generations. And where are they? You know, right now, only 14% of the Soviet population, according to the latest polls, has full trust in the Communist Party. That's less than they have in the Soviet Army and even the KGB. I mean, it's the lowest in terms of confidence of the population. So it's a total fiasco. Something like 20% think the October Revolution was a good thing. What they have done is completely ruined human spirit, human morale, immorality. And this is a real problem. And people who conduct polls in the Soviet Union, like Tatiana Soslavskaya, are appalled by the kind of apathy, the kind of immorality, the general...
Well, now, how ought that to instruct our foreign policy on the basis of what you your philosophical points? This tells James Baker what?
You're dealing with a very sick society, and don't think that if you're going to give them $1 billion worth of food credits or even a couple of million dollars worth of dollars, that it's going to cure anything. This is a very sick and unstable society. And
well, that's just a palliative, isn't it, that billion
dollars? Oh, yes. I don't object to it, but it's a palliative. And I think, don't believe for a moment that you're dealing with a healthy society that's on its way to democratization and the free market. It's not.
Well, what your antecedent point was that there's nothing we can do to push it in that direction. We simply have to keep hands off.
To a large extent, yes.
Yeah. And the forces within, what would be the worst case scenario involving the generals? Let's say that they had a push, they suppressed your book. Would they reinstitute the KGB and the practices of the Gulag and become an international nuclear menace?
Well, the KGB
would they revive Bolshevism?
KGB does not have to suppress. The KGB is there, and we know it's operating as it always did.
No, I say, were they reactivated in its old nefarious purposes?
Well, if it's engaged in surveillance and spying and listening to telephone conversations, illustration of correspondence, indiscriminate terror, I think this is very unlikely, because I think they found it counterproductive. And I think no one supports the kind of Stalinist terror of the 30s, but in terms of arresting and sentencing people who are obnoxious politically, no question, they would love to do it. And in terms of becoming a nuclear menace, yes, the generals, some of the prominent generals are even now saying that the Soviet Union is retreating all the time, Uncle Sam is winning. One Russian general, very prominent Russian general, said recently that World War III is already underway and the United States is winning it. They have, I think, forced the Soviet government to raise defense expenditures for the coming year.
Yeah.
So I think you can be quite certain.
Well, let me ask you this, though. Is it possible in this scenario to activate the moribund ideology that gives them the afflatus to go out and conquer the world and dominate the world? Mm-hmm. Or would they simply become a conventional superpower?
I don't think you could go back to the old ideology, but you could inflame Russian nationalism in its chauvinistic form.
And what ways would it likely express itself?
Well, that
would it become a nuclear terror again?
Well, we Russians are a great nation. We are a supreme nation, and we will not let go of the Ukraine. We will not let go of the other republics, and we ought to be a world power. And we ought not to give up Eastern Europe. There was a mistake, and if possible, we should recover Eastern Europe.
I mean, even that is conceivable.
Well, it's conceivable. They have still troops in East Germany, and they are delaying withdrawing them. They have two divisions in
Poland.
But
they're scheduled to go out by the middle of next year.
Yeah. Well, they are withdrawing them very slowly.
Yeah.
There are some doubts about the destruction of various weapons which they're committed to eliminate. And all kinds of very odd things are happening. And the nuclear program goes forward apace. Still, the Prime Minister of the Russian Republic, which is the principal republic in terms of defense industries, revealed the other day that 55% of all industries in the Russian Republic are engaged in military production. So nothing has changed. So all you have to do is just change the labels, and you're back in business.
Yes, but there has to be an animating, a harnessing evangelistic doctrine that motivates them. Now, why would they engage in massive military expansion unless there was an objective in mind? And I'm asking you, has the end of Bolshevik ideology signified a termination of an appetite to dominate the world on behalf of the proletarian revolution?
In this particular form, yes. But even before Gorbachev, certainly under Stalin, and his successors, the animating spirit behind the Russian global expansionism and global threats was chauvinism and xenophobia, and not communism. You could do a lot with that. I mean, Nazis showed it, and Mussolini showed it. You don't have to have this particular ideology, which never sunk deep roots anywhere among the people.
And how would we most prudently guard against that possibility?
Oh, very little we can do, except for one thing, not disarm ourselves.
Mm-hmm.
If we start really cutting back on our armaments production, if we really break up NATO, all of this prematurely, then we may be caught with a very unpleasant surprise.
Mm-hmm.
So I think we have to keep all of this in place.
Is the Soviet Union, under its present leadership, disposed to cooperate with the United States in the development of SDI, of Star Wars, on the grounds that it might be contingently useful against a third power, a mad Iraq or Libya?
Well, I'm not privy to the kind of confidential exchanges, but on the official level, no. They are dead set against SDI.
And what reasons do they give for that?
Well, the reason is that the power that first succeeds in developing defenses against nuclear weapons will be in a position to threaten everybody else.
But what if it were done jointly?
If you do it jointly. I don't think we'll be so willing to share the technology of ourselves. In any event, I have not seen any effort on the part to cooperate with us on this.
I think I can reveal that when Sakharov met the first time in history, met Professor Teller at a banquet it happened that I was the master of ceremonies, it was arranged to give to Professor Sakharov in Russian details of the extent to which the Soviet Union was experimenting with SDI, because it was assumed by the relevant community in Washington that he didn't know that, and that his attitude towards SDI might be influenced if he were aware of the extent to which his own country was involved, $25 billion a year.
Yes.
Now, probably if you know the inside story, you wouldn't feel free to tell it. Yes. But I wonder whether active statesmanship is attempting to engage Soviet leadership in collaborative work on SDI of a kind that would help us both and protect us against third powers.
I don't know that this, in fact, is going on. I'd be surprised if it is.
Well, are you, when you say leave them alone, you don't object to giving them $1 billion worth of food, irrespective of the fact that they're continuing to maximize their military?
Well, you know, we did this in the early 1920s under the American Relief Administration. We saved a lot of lives, rightly so. It was a conservative president-to-be, Herbert Hoover,
well,
who did
Belgium
it.
Well, Belgium was no threat.
No. We gave it to the Soviet Union, I'm talking.
Oh, the Soviet Union, yeah,
yes,
sure.
Yes,
yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, we sent enormous quantities of food to the Volga during the famine, where 25 million people were hungry and 5 million perished. I don't know how many lives we saved, but in the millions. I don't think there's any such threat now, but I think on humanitarian grounds, we ought not to punish the people for the sins of the government.
Mm-hmm.
It's another matter if, by waiving the Jackson-Vanik Amendment, we were to give them access to import-export bank credits, billions of dollars to go into bolstering their industrial production for defense,
yeah,
and assisting them spending more money on Cuba, Vietnam, North Korea, and all the other communist dictatorships. I think if we're going to give them such aid, the very least we should require is that they cut off all aid to these communist dictatorships.
Well, I was told in Moscow this summer by Gerasimov that effective the first of the year, they would cease to subsidize the oil that they send to, mm-hmm, Cuba, or to pay more for sugar than the world price. Mm-hmm. Is that policy?
Well, that indeed was the policy a few months ago, but now they're beginning to sing a slightly different tune. And you see, you're beginning to feel the winds of right-wing reaction, and all sorts of things which they intended to do, and I think honestly said they would do, they now are beginning to renege on.
Because of the military weight?
Yeah. The military regard, the Russian military, were gaining a lot of influence, regard the Cuba as a very important base, very important outpost. So just as Gorbachev and Shevardnadze said they're willing to send troops to the Gulf, and then they reneged on it, so now they're beginning to say, well, perhaps this would be too brutal to cut off this assistance to Cuba right away, and I'd be surprised if they cut it off.
Is it your judgment that the generals were against the Soviet Union's acquiescence in the Security Council vote on Iraq?
I think they did not, that's my impression, I have no inside information on this, but my impression is that they wanted themselves to stay entirely out of Iraq, because out of this whole Iraq business, because Iraq was the primary client of the Soviet Union, the Soviet Army, main supplier of the Iraqi Army and the Soviet Army. When they saw that the Gorbachev administration is ready not only to assist us, but even to send troops, they struck a compromise, I think, saying, okay, support the United States diplomatically, but not true.
Excuse me, Professor Pipes. Mr. Buckley, do you agree with Professor Pipes that despite all that's gone on in the past 2 years, the collapse of communism, if not leaving aside the rebirth of Russian nationalism, that we can't afford to let down our guard even now, that we must maintain NATO at its full military power and so on and so forth?
I think the nature of the defense shield changes to accommodate a fresh situation, but certainly I think I would agree with you that we need to maintain our deterrent force, mm-hmm, against the contingency that ugly people will take charge of this stuff. After all, it's there, 12,000 nuclear warheads, to use the symbol I used before in your presence, 500 million times the strength of the bomb that fell over Hiroshima, so that unless that stuff is sent to Switzerland for safekeeping, it seems to me elementary that one needs to... I mean, now, whether the shape of our defense policy can legitimately change here and there to accommodate reality is a technical question.
Yes, I think that should be left to the generals. But in principle, it is too early, I think, to talk about the end of the Cold War. You know, I must leave that to the historians of the future to decide. Mm-hmm. And as long as Soviet Union is so unstable, and as long as there is a risk of a right-wing backlash, which will be led by very belligerent people, I don't think we can afford to start disarming or breaking up NATO.
In your judgment, is the current administration, the president of the administration, doing as much as it ought to do against that possibility?
I on the whole, support what the administration is doing, but I think it's coming under increased pressure from the Democratic Party in this country and from some allies, and I'm just afraid they may start yielding to that.
Would you like to see them spending more on SDI?
I would, yes. I'm a great believer in SDI.
I do.
And not only because of the Soviet threat, but as you said, Third World threat.
Thank you, Professor Pipes, author of The Russian Revolution, Mr. Kinsley, ladies and gentlemen from Scarsdale. Merry Christmas.
Funding for Firing Line was made possible by a major grant from the John M. Olin Foundation, Incorporated. Additional support is provided by the Mobile Corporation. L. John Polite, Jr., the Friends of Firing Line, and by the financial support of viewers like you.